I think that we can maybe start with presenting the webinar of today. So I give the floor to Bas Arends from the Dutch Embassy.
Yes, thank you so much, Federico. Buon pomeriggio. Goedemiddag, good afternoon. My name is Bas Ernst, and I'm cultural attaché at the embassy in Rome, the Dutch embassy. It's my pleasure welcoming you all to this second webinar this day, today about engagement and audiences. Also, on behalf of the team of BAM Strategia Culturali, with whom we are conducting this research on digitization in the heritage sector. And I'm joined today by Federico Boiani, he already spoke to you, he's the moderator of today, but also by Milo Sarini and Vanessa Gregory. As I explained last week, the reason why we focus on digital heritage is that both the Netherlands and Italy aim for digital innovation in the heritage sector. Our two countries are working on ambitious plans to fully embrace the opportunities these technological innovations offer. The reason why we are organizing these webinars is to get a better understanding of the common challenges that the heritage sectors and organizations are facing, and for us to develop new lines of actions for Dutch-Italian collaborations. Last week, we discussed networks and data. It was interesting to see that Dutch and Italian organizations face similar challenges, and that's important for us to know, of course. And also, we heard some amazing stories about what heritage institutions can do with their own data. We learned how important it is to work together in a network, as organizations are not always able to do everything on their own. Sometimes necessary skills and competences are lacking, which have to be provided by others. Last week's session also anticipated the subject of today, the engagement of the audience. Most of our guests told us how they put the users at the center of their projects. Also was pointed out that new opportunities can arise by giving certain audience groups the ability to interact with their resources. Today, we will dive deeper into the topic of engagements of audiences. And to do this, we have invited six organizations, three from the Netherlands and three from Italy. I will just mention them briefly. We have the Dutch Cultural Heritage Agency, My Daily Shot of Culture and the project The Home Museum, a Thijs Museum, and the Royal Netherlands Institute in Rome. From Italy, we welcome the Royal Museums of Turin, the National Archaeological Museum of Taranto, and the project Rhapsodia Digitali of the archaeological site Ostia Antica. As an embassy and cultural general, consulate general, we focus on the international dimension of digital heritage. This will be one of our priorities for the coming years. We are conducting this research with BAM to develop a program with hopefully meaningful projects. Sessions like today help identify opportunities for collaboration. These sessions are not an end in itself, but part of a longer process. Today's webinar helps us building up networks, starting a dialogue on what is needed, and developing tailor-made instruments. It's a form of co-creation in which we develop together with our partners an agenda for the coming years. We have decided to open these sessions, giving our guests the possibility to tell their stories to a larger audience. And it's wonderful to notice that again, so many people, like last week, are following us online. And thank you all so much for being with us here today. So let's start. I leave the floor to our moderator, Federico Boiani, for his introduction of today's program. And I wish you all a very inspiring webinar. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you, Bas. I hope you can hear me properly and see me properly. I'm very glad to introduce this new webinar. It was very particularly interesting last week, and I'm sure that this will be a great second part. I also thank personally our six guests. I'm not repeating their name because Bas already introduced your six institutions, and I will give you the floor in a few seconds. Just a few words. BAM Strategie Culturali is a cultural consultancy based in Bologna, Italy. We work in audience development and audience engagement projects, digital strategies for cultural institutions, and European projects, and many other themes, and we work next to the cultural institutions in Italy to face this kind of challenges. So I'm very glad to be here with you today. The occasion that we have today will be divided. This webinar is divided in two parts. We will have six presentations in the first part. Then we'll have a 10 minutes break around 3:30, and then a second part of dialogue between our guests. And the second part of this dialogue will be held in Italian, because we want to focus a bit more on the Italian situations and Italian challenges. The theme of today's webinar is engagement and audiences. After last week, when we decided to focus on how cultural institutions can build digital collections and digital library, and so they share data and they organize their data online, this second webinar will be focused on how digital projects of cultural institutions can reach new audiences or deepen the relations with these audiences, and can also start a brand new way of intending cultural contents and intending reading cultural contents and reading the cultural heritage. We would like to understand from our guests how cultural institutions and organizations can also change their functioning, change their services and products, change the way they are organized thanks to digital projects and thanks to digital approaches. So we are also looking for organizational change, reflections about competencies and strategies of dealing with audiences. The spectators, the 64 right now people that are hearing to this webinar, can also interact with us in a specific chat, which is called questions and answers. You see it on the bottom of your Zoom screen, Q&A or domande e risposte in Italian. If you have something to ask to our guests, you can do it through this chat. And the guests will be maybe answering directly, or we will answer from their part. So if we don't have any other question or other things to add, I will give you the floor to the first speaker for the first 10 minutes presentation. I will warn you briefly when you are reaching the end of your time, of your available time. And I give the floor for the first presentation to Hannah Pennock, of the Cultural Heritage Agency from the Ministry of Education, Culture and Science of the Netherlands. Hello, Anna.
Yes, good afternoon. Hello, everybody. Hello, Federico. Thank you very much for inviting me. And Milo will be so kind to share my presentation. Let's wait for that. Yeah. Okay. Thank you very much. Well, good afternoon, everybody. I will tell you a bit more about our projects that we did on traces of slavery and colonial history in the museum collections. We made several experiences, and I will tell you more about it with the next slide. First, a short introduction, who we are, and then I will tell you about the project and the examples of what we found in collections and the publications we made on this. Next one. So I work at the Cultural Heritage Agency of the Netherlands, which is an expertise center, and it's part of the Ministry of Education, Culture and Science, as Federico already said. We deal mainly with listed monuments, cultural landscapes, archaeology, and movable heritage. And I myself am mostly active within the field of the movable heritage. I think it relates mostly to your former Ministero dei Beni Culturali. We also keep a part of the state collection. The state collection is large, and it's divided among over 25 museums. Just to name you a few examples, the Rijksmuseum or the Van Gogh Museum or the Museum of Antiquities, etc. We also have a collection, but we don't have a museum ourselves. We keep about 100,000 objects, and the main thing we want to do with that is give them on loan to museums so that they can be shown, or on loan to ministries and embassies. If you go to the Dutch Institute, I think in the Dutch embassy, you're sure you'll find some of our pieces of art. And we also have a large part in storage. And next slide shows you the brand. It's such a big storage that it doesn't even enter the slide. Am I right? I only see just a fragment of the next slide. Milo? No, go back. Yes, this one. I wanted to show you our brand new storage facility. It's it opened last year, and it's a combination of four institutions, our collection of the Cultural Heritage Agency, and also it's the storage of the Rijksmuseum, the Open Air Museum, and the Royal Palace Het Lo. So this is where part of our collection is located. Next one, please. So if we look at the developments, the context now of our projects, we live in a diverse society. And we have lots of discussions recently, last 10, 15 years, on colonial past, on stereotypes, racism, white supremacy, etc. The Rijksmuseum in Amsterdam organized an exhibition on slavery last year, which was quite a new thing also for that museum. We have lots of critical reviews of collections and their history. And we find in our databases of the collections, which by now are online, descriptions and terms that are incomplete or outdated or even offensive or derogatory. So what we see is we are shifting from a single-sided perspective to multiple viewpoints. And this, of course, is not only in the Netherlands, it's an international movement. Next slide. This is, I found this one on the internet. It's from 2016 in the Natural History Museum in New York, where people gather on Columbus Day, they gather outside the museum and then go into the museum to protest and to decolonize the museum by presenting alternative tours, alternative stories to the collections on show in the Natural History Museum. Next one. So what we did is we started a research into our collection, because we also use it as a sort of a laboratory to do interesting things that museums sometimes don't have time for. And we wanted to find traces of or objects that have links with the colonial past. And of course, this is a new topic. It's not included in the data. You cannot find it using keywords in the database or whatever. And often the title or the description doesn't give any lead. So what we did is we developed a sort of a method to go through our collection. And for that, we used a list of search terms, and we were helped. We always work together with external parties, so we always search information from others. We search in sub-collections like this portrait here. We have 18th, 19th century portraits in which you can expect to find people who have a link with this colonial past. We looked into the old inventory cards because our collection was already digitized in the 1980s. And it was then done by data typists, and they didn't take on all the information from the cards. And we looked for artists where we knew we would find something, like artists who had worked in Indonesia or something like that. And also we used our eyes. Just going through the storage, you always find new things, actually. And since our small team, I was the project manager, consisted of three ladies 50 plus, all white, and we thought it would be wise to have a diverse advisory board of about 12 people, people who were interested in the topic, doing research in it, or experts in certain fields of art history. Next slide. They helped us and to find our blind spots. So I give you two examples of portraits in our collection, and I give you a fragment of the description as it was in our database, and I highlighted in English, in white, how the black figures, the servants, the black persons were described. In this one, it says it's a Negro boy in white, red striped coat and a silver collar. And in the next one, we have one which in the next slide, we have one which says a person in the background without really saying anything. And in this painting, the black boy is not mentioned at all. And of course, these are all traces of slavery and colonial history, and we want to find these objects in our collection. And of course, we have curators who know the collection very well, but in this large collection, they cannot know everything. So we did this search. And the next slide gives a very good example, I think, of sugar casters who are early 18th century, and they would be described in your database, in your collection database, as Chinese porcelain with a silver knob. But of course, this has a direct link with the sugar plantations, with colonial history and with slavery. And if you want to show objects like this in your museum or in a publication, you want to add also by now this extra layer, this extra meaning, this part of the history that these objects tell as well. Next one, please. Just to give you an idea of these search terms, we had a long list with main terms like slave, Moor, Negro, Marron, which is Suriname, or servant, and all other terms that had more or less to do with that. It's it's a very easy tool to find connections in your collection. Next one. And, you know, doing such a research in your collection is really eye-opening. Like, we had this China cabinet, you know, a large, like the one here behind me, actually, something like that, a cupboard. And there were these fittings showing a figure with a feather headdress. And we would have never noticed it ourselves, but while we were doing this research, one of the collection keepers who works in the storage noticed this and brought it to us as another finding. So doing such a research really brings a lot of awareness within your organization. And the next one. Of course, we also want to share our findings with the museum world. We work then mainly for collection keepers. And we made several publications. We made an e-magazine in Dutch and translated it into this one. It's a PDF, and I gave the location on the internet, in which we give an account of our research, and we took 25 good objects that tell the story, and we ask to have this diversity in approach as well. For each object, we ask three different persons to give a description of it from their own viewpoint, and that can be very personal, it can be emotional, it can be art historical, scientific, etc. And it gives a very good. It's really nice to read. If I may say so, it gives a good view of how you can approach objects in very different ways, and it can be very confrontational, actually. Also, the next one.
Sorry, Anna, your time is running up, so I have to speed you up a bit.
I will. I'm finishing. We have to with these findings. We have to then enrich and adapt the collection information. Just as an example, we have these titles. In Dutch, sneeuwneger, snow negro. The painter is also a poet, and you hear in the word sneeuwneger that there's an internal rhyme. It's certainly his title. And although we don't want to use the word negro, neger anymore, in this case, we don't want to, we want to keep it. So we put it in quotation marks. And we add in our database now info on the persons, we add context, and we add keywords to find this sub, this new sub collection. And the next one, which is the last slide. And in October, then we published a guide for museums to how to start such a research in their own collection like we did. And we were going to launch it in December, but of course, thanks to Corona, we had to postpone that, but it is online and it's already received pretty well in the meantime. But this is how we share our experiences with the museum field, and then they can share it with the public by presenting their collections in other ways with new layers of meaning. Thank you. Thank you, Milo.
Thank you, Anna. It's very interesting when you talked at the beginning about moving forward from a single point of view to a shared and multiple point of view on your collections. And this is exactly something that happens when you go digital. Since we said go digital, I think that's also the name of the next project. So I pass the word to Rosella Arcadi from the Royal Museums of Turin, I Musei Reali di Torino.
Good evening to everyone. I'm Rosella Arcadi from Musei Reali of Turin. I want you to show some photos of the Musei. Can you see my monitor or not?
Yes, we do, Rosella.
Okay.
Yes.
Thank you. First of all, I want to introduce the Musei Reali. It's a state institution created just in 2014, so recently. For the development of the integrated management of the Savoy Royal Collection of Turin. The museum is formed by the Royal Palace, which was the Savoy permanent resident and chapel of Holy, this Royal Palace, the chapel, Holy Shroud, then...
Rosella, I think you yes. you are changing the slides because we see the first. We only see the first now. If you want to start the presentation, you should
click here. Stay on this image. Can you see the Royal Palace?
Yeah, we do.
Va bene. there are many sections in the Musei Reali, the Chapel of Holy Shroud, Royal Armory, Royal Library, Sabauda Painting Gallery, and Archaeological Museum, and also Royal Gardens. All these different spaces now are part of an integrated museum that can be visited with a single ticket. Go Digital, so, is a strategic plan of digital transformation for the museum. Quindi, so a complex project that involves the whole organization and will affect administrative processes, collections, enhancement, and services to audiences that has to be developed in 15 months. Go Digital arose following a call for proposals named Switch Strategies for Tools for Digital Transformation in Culture, published by San Paolo Company in February 2020. This call wanted to finance strategic plans of digital transformation for cultural institution. And so our plan was selected and financed. Our plan is based on the idea that each digital tool can help us to achieve a different goal. So we are developing different ones. Some will improve audiences' visit experience. Others will improve internal organization and administrative processes. In 10 minutes, I want to focus on some tools we are developing in this time. As we know, for a museum, for us, it's very important to start and maintain relationships with stakeholders such as visitors, schools, donors, So the first tool we are developing is a CRM system. For us is the more complex tool because until now we have never collected data on our audiences, only mail contact, for example, to send newsletter. With the CRM system, we'll implement a database with more data provided by the online ticketing system, which will allow us to know gender, age, nationality, most buyer services, and also time of greatest affluence, for example. Other data will be provided to CRM system by other touch points, such as website, app, and registration forms on website. For us, with CRM system, will be possible to manage contacts, for example, with schools or with potential partners who would like to use museums spaces for private events. And we'll be able to profile audiences and then promote cultural initiatives, exhibitions, events. With the CRM, for us, will be possible also to manage fundraising activities and membership. In fact, recently we have activated a membership to support Royal Gardens, and therefore CRM will be used to promote exclusive activities for members. As I said before, we are remaking our website. New website will offer lots of contents, more clear information with the primary goals of facilitating the experience of pre-visit. So planning visit, getting information, buying tickets before coming. An important section we are developing on our website is a section named Rightly. This section will allow users to request the use of images that comes directly from our online catalog and to pay royalties when needed without communicating with an operator. In fact, in the disease analysis phase, when we written GoDigital, we have calculated that the process the manual process of requesting images normally commits two people full time. So we think that automating this process will allow us to assign these two people on other more qualifying, interesting, and creative activities. Another project that is part of GoDigital has the goal to facilitate the on-site experience. As Royal Museum include different sections connected to each other in a single path, visitors are often disoriented on finding the collections they are interested on. So we are developing and will be introduced in the coming months some display located along the museum tour. That will help visitors with information on services, suggested paths based on available time to spend in the museum or on possible interests. We also will position some displays for customer satisfaction in some strategic places that will encourage visitors to give us their opinion on museum and on services they have used along the way. This information will be automatically sent to the CRM, and in this way, we can collect other profiling data on user satisfaction and user satisfaction data. Then, in order to facilitate the use of the technologies that will be placed in the museum, free Wi-Fi will also be activated. Another important part of the project is an app of gamification. We know museums audience isn't an homogeneous group, but consists of many segments, each with its own interests and needs. So in order to engage the youngest one, we are developing a gamification app. We believe gamification is essential to achieve these two goals. On the one hand, to engage new audiences, especially younger ones, and on the other hand, to offer new activities to do on site to regular audiences that for us are families. Last, we have implemented a control dashboard based on KPI that will show management of current outlay of investment funds assigned to us by ministry or by banking foundations. And through infographics, we made available to director information to support strategic choices. Last, Go Digital, we have an important impact on the side of internal process because new technological tools will be introduced in working activities. And in June, we all the staff was involved in a development soft skill program. And as new technologies will be introduced, also technical training session will be activated. I finish.
Grazie Rosella, thank you. As you were the first Italian institution going with your presentation, and it's very interesting to see how you are working on a digital shift in a very general sense. So we are not thinking about collections data or relations with audiences, but we are thinking about a new form of organization that has to take shape in a few months. So you are very lucky to have had the opportunity to go for this kind of project, but it's also very challenging, I imagine. So afterwards, we will ask you maybe something else about it. I will give the floor to our third presenter. We are coming back to the Netherlands and with the Thijs Museum. And so I ask to Jip Heimering to start with her presentation.
Yes. Hello, everybody. I still see the presentation of Rosella, I think. So she could stop the presentation, I can open mine. Or can I just start and open my presentation? I don't know how it works.
Let's try to do so. But Rosella, do you have any? Okay, great.
Yes. Okay, cool. I'm gonna share mine. Share. So does it work? You see my presentation?
Okay, perfect. Yes, we do.
Okay. Hello, everybody. My name is Jip Heimering. I'm from the Netherlands, and I'm the owner and founder of My Daily Shot of Culture, which is a cultural company in the Netherlands. And we recently started the project Thijs Museum, which literally means museum at home. And I'm very honored to tell you something about these two things today. But I'll start shortly with who am I? So as I said, I'm the founder of My Daily Shot of Culture and Thijs Museum. I studied, I did the Master Museum Studies at the University of Amsterdam and the Bachelor Cultural Sciences, which is mainly about Dutch and European culture. And I focused always on combining culture and entrepreneurship. So that's why in 2016, I started my own company, which is called My Daily Shot of Culture. A little bit about that. The first thing, we do everything in Dutch, so I don't have, I have a lot of video material, but it's all, well, not very understandable for the audience. So I try to talk you through it. But we started with the aim to reach a young audience. I think that's my second point, yeah. So in the Netherlands, I think in Italy, my guess would be it's a little bit the same. Usually cultural institutions and especially museums have a hard time to reach the group between 25 and 45 years old. Usually children, when they're younger, they go through school to culture, they visit culture or 50 plus, people have more time and money again. And this group in between, especially in the Netherlands, for museums is hard to reach. On the other hand, I met a lot of artists, small cultural projects, entrepreneurs such as me, who do and organize a lot of really nice things, but they don't have, until we came, I think, they didn't have an online cultural platform to promote their activities or their project. So that's, one of the two things we combined with starting my Daily Shot of Culture. How did we reach this this audience, these young people? That's we combined vlogging, vlogs, videos, blogging, but also sharing photos on Instagram, really using the online tools and social media to reach this group of young people. And I think in 2016, we were the first, and still we are the biggest culture vlogging platform in the Netherlands. But I even think internationally, we, for example, registered a domain internet website name, culturevlogger.com, artvlogger.com. So even internationally, it was not done in such a specific way. So I think we're at least one of the first to specifically focus on culture. As I said, we promote this on Facebook, Instagram, and YouTube. And nowadays we reach about 100,000 people each month through these different channels. But today I've been asked to tell you something about Thuis Museum, or Museum at Home, or Home Museum. That will be the direct translation. We started this in March 2020 during the first lockdown in the Netherlands. So all the cultural institution followed, I think, our Italian colleagues with closing down, not being able to receive people and show the art. And we decided to start this platform to still provide art to people, even during the lockdown, also helping the cultural institution, but I'll come back to that in my next slide. But I'll share with you already the results since then. So 1.5 years, almost 2 years ago, we've reached 2 million people in the Netherlands with our videos and tours. We have 2.8 thousand followers on YouTube with an average view time of 4:41, which for some people who are a little bit in the marketing sector is quite long, and especially 2.8K followers in the Netherlands is quite big. It's about, to compare, we have more followers than 90% of the museums in the Netherlands, and we have a lot of museums there. So it might not be so much if you compare it to the big YouTube channels all around the world, but we are in a very specific niche, very specific subject. So in that case, we still, we're quite proud of what we achieved in this short amount of time. Since then, we visited 114 museums, and we grew from 3 to 7 vloggers, people who are filming for us. So what is it exactly? How does it work, Thuis Museum? Of course, all the museums were closing down. There were a lot of regulation, 1.5 meter distance, and all the museums had to close. But of course, as you know, the museums cannot just turn the key and leave the building. The art has to be protected. There's always security, climatized of the circumstances in the museum. And as a vlogger, you do everything yourself. You are alone. So between all this regulation, we are one of the few people who could still enter these museums and expose all the art, all this beautiful art that was closed off for a lot of people to a bigger audience. So we said one vlogger, one museum. And then the second thing was we came up with the idea to make the format for one video as easy as possible, because normally it takes 5 days for us to produce, at least 5 working days to produce one video. And if you want to help a lot of museums, of course, we have to make it faster or produce faster. So we decided to do a one take video, which means no cuts. The camera is on for 15 minutes. Everything that happens, happens on the video. And that we just upload. So the editing process, we made up to maybe 10 minutes. First of all, it was maybe 16 hours to produce one video, and now it's only 10 minutes. So that made a big difference. And we discussed 5 art pieces, which we decided or we choose together with the curator. So how did we end up reaching 2 million people? First, we determine our goals. And the first one, of course, I already told you, was to provide cultural visit for audience during the lockdown. We still think it's very important. It keeps you alert. It helps you processing all the strange things that are happening. And I think museums are a big and important way to do this. And second of all, of course, helping the cultural sector. And that's when we decided we will make these videos. People can watch it. The audience can watch these tours, museum tours, for free. But we do ask them to do a donation to the museum or give them some money to support. What were our challenges? The video format, as I said, first of all, it took us a long time. Now we made it shorter. That's one thing how we tackled this challenge. We made it as easy as possible. And that also comes to the next challenge was, on one hand, we decided we want to help these museums, but we are a very small company. We also have to survive. And of course, it costs us money, the cost of making a video. We try to keep this as low as possible so the museums could still afford to invite us, but it would still help them by receiving donations from the audience. So it was a bit of a difficult challenge, I have to say, but this is how we kind of managed to overcome this. So what was remarkable about our project, this is a print screen from our YouTube channel, but I will explain. I told you My Daily Shot of Culture, our audience is 90% is between 25 and 45. But here for Thijs Museum, 40% of the audience is above 55 years, which was really new for us. And it really made us a challenge also to change our videos a bit to, be suitable for these 55 and older. And what was very remarkable that we've worked mainly with smaller museums. We saw that probably in Italy it's the same. The big museums have a lot of money. They already have a lot of people in their staff to, for example, create video or online platforms. The smaller museums, they don't have it. And now for the first time they could afford, because this format was so simple and the costs were so low, that they could afford us to come by. And these 114 museums consist mainly of small museums spread throughout the whole Netherlands. So they, through Thijs Museum, they could work together and enforce their position during the lockdown, which, is really cool, I think. And a really nice thing that I didn't expect it, that we got a big sponsorship from a lottery in the Netherlands. They wanted to help their partner museums. And they did that by giving a tour from us as a present to these museums. So they paid us a good amount of money, so the costs didn't have to be that low, so that was good for us. On the other hand, the museums were very happy that we were coming by and promoting them. I'm almost finished. we are almost 2 years, it's 2 years later after we started Thijs Museum. We determined 2 goals. Instead of donation, which kind of worked, but we noticed that a lot of museums were way more happy with us promoting their exhibition. As soon as they can open again, they ask us to promote their new exhibition or their collection. So instead of we saying donate money, we say go to the museum. It's safe. It's a good location. It's between all the regulation. You can have a safe visit. And please spend there as much money as possible. Spread the word. Visit the museum. But secondly, we also got a lot of reactions of people saying, for example, who are 90 years plus, or people who are disabled, for example, or financially not possible to come travel all through the Netherlands. They are so happy with our platform. So we still also have a goal that the videos should be interesting and nice to watch also if you are not able to go to the museum. And our plans for this year, we are planning to add more formats. So I'm talking about the very simple format, one take video. Now we are looking at creating some content that is more broadly about culture, about art, about artists. And we're also maybe thinking going abroad, maybe I can come to Italy, or we don't know yet what to come, but one thing for sure, we're not gonna stop with Thijs Museum, because I think it's a good value and helpful for the Dutch museums. All right, thank you very much for your attention. I hope I was in between the 10 minutes.
Thank you very much, Jip. It was super interesting and very, very clear. I tell to all the friends that are listening to us, our auditors and audiences, that if they have some questions for you, they can write on the Q&A sections, because you will not be with us in the second part of the webinar because you're not speaking Italian. I'm so sorry. So we cannot have you there for the discussion. So if someone has something to ask you, he or she can do it online now. We pass the word to the fourth intervention. So we come back to Italy and we go to Taranto, to the museum, the National Archaeological Museum of Taranto. So I pass the word to Lorenzo Mancini. Good afternoon, Lorenzo. Thank you to be here.
Hello, everybody. Thank you. And I'm a curator and chief archaeologist at the National Archaeological Museum of Taranto. And I will speak on behalf of the director, Eva degli Innocenti, who will join us for discussion. So let me share my... Okay. Just a moment. It's not working, I don't know. Okay, so.
Ci siamo.
Can you see properly?
Yeah, you just have to launch the presentation, maybe with the launching button of.
Actually, I haven't launched it, but. So can you see the second slide now?
No, we are still on the first.
Okay, I'm, so I'm...
You should try to click on the button next to the minus, or now we see the third slide.
I clicked on this button, but... So
it doesn't work.
So I can see on presentation view, but I don't know.
But we don't, so you can just click on the slides and it's okay. I think you can click on the slides in the left column.
Now you can see the second one.
Yes.
Okay, perfect. So let me first introduce the institution, the National Archaeological Museum of Taranto, located along the Ionian coast of Puglia. Is one of the most important archaeological museums, not only of Italy, and a real point of reference for the knowledge of ancient Magna Graecia, that is that part of southern Italy that was settled during the antiquity by Greek colonists. To this period belong the tomb of the Athlete of Taranto, one of the museum's highlights, and the world-famous section of gold artifacts dating to the late classical and Hellenistic period. But the exhibition itinerary, completely renewed over the past 10 years, covers a much longer period than the Greek phase, ranging between prehistory and the beginning of Middle Ages. The national operational program called Malta 3.0, funded by the European Regional Development Fund 2014-2020, aims at reconnecting this glorious past to the presence of the city and its surrounding areas, and above all, to the idea of future. Past for future, a blend of tradition and innovation substantiated by research, education, inclusion, and development, is the concept chosen as the new Malta's payoff and symbolized by the image of the rising sun in the restyled museum logo. And the creation of a new coordinated image of the museum, including the renewing of its online and offline communication strategy and the launch of a new multilingual website, was the first step of an exciting cultural challenge aiming at renewing and extending the museum array of cultural resources by leveraging the most modern ICT technologies and delivering innovative and interactive contents to enhance the emotional involvement, social engagement, and empowerment of visitors. The Malta 3.0 project, which in 2021 earned the museum the prestigious award for digital innovation in cultural heritage, conferred by the Polytechnic of Milan in memory of Gianluca Spina, covers multiple areas summarized in this slide. Okay. Alongside the implementation of technological infrastructures for back office activities, a cornerstone of the project is represented by the classification and digitalization of the museum collections. Qualified external collaborators with the coordination of the museum scientific staff are currently cataloging and making a new inventory of 40,000 archaeological items from both the permanent exhibition and the museum storehouses, preserving context and materials of enormous interest, which will finally be made available to the scientific community and the general public through an open data and open source digital archive. The most interesting context identified in the course of this systematic survey of the storehouses will be put on display as part of the forthcoming integration and reorganization of the exhibition itinerary, making a large use of multimedia devices and immersive contents in order to promote active participation, inclusion, and emotional involvement of the public. An example of this approach is the LiFi Light Fidelity project. This project, which sees the Malta as the first Italian museum to use LiFi technology, favors the widest accessibility to the cultural heritage with the aim of making the museum visit as engaging as possible for the visitor. Thanks to the modeling of the light emitted by LED diodes positioned in correspondence with 25 points of interest along the exhibition itinerary, visitors can activate multimedia contents relating to the most important items of the museum on their mobile phones. Another novelty stemmed from Malta 3.0 project is the Fab Lab or Malta Lab, the in-house digital craft laboratory of the National Archaeological Museum of Taranto. The management of the Fab Lab using 3D scanning, modeling, and printing technologies, robotics and laser cutting for different purposes, such as education, social inclusion, scientific research, and merchandising, has been entrusted for 5 years to a private society after a public tender according to an innovative model of governance, combining private and public resources. I show you a short video about Malta Lab. Okay. Okay, so our Fab Lab also fulfill an important educational function towards the community and the territory, carried out even in the course of the national lockdown, thanks to e-learning and distant learning platforms. And here it is. Okay, some pictures. Other ways to maintain the relationship with the public despite the restriction due to the COVID-19 pandemic were the Malta's Wednesdays, weekly scientific and cultural dissemination events broadcast in live streaming through our YouTube channel and Facebook page, and the virtual 3D tour of the museum. The latter offers an immersive visit experience through the 6,000 square meters of exhibition spaces with insight into the most important finds, thanks to the connection with a donation platform, as can be seen in this video. Okay. Okay, this was just a sample. The proceeds from a donation, which in December 2020, with the museum closed, almost doubled those obtained in the previous year from the sale of tickets, this is very important, can thus be allocated to other education and research activities. Actually, the Malta 3.0 enhancement project is only part of a broader strategy for the requalification and revitalization of the museum as a cultural hub. Our intent is to permeate the social and cultural fabric of Taranto and its surrounding areas, too often reduced to their environmental and social problems, generating a virtuous circle that supports, forms, and informs processes of social innovation. Past for future means having a dynamic vision of cultural heritage and being able to pass it on to new generation with a communicative style capable of speaking to a younger audience. This explains the importance attributed by the Malta 3.0 project to social media management, which saw our museum already active on Facebook and Instagram, land on TikTok as well, with its own channel dedicated to millennials. I saw you just a short sample. Okay. That's not all, because since last October, the museum is also present on Spotify with a playlist specifically designed to accompany the visitor on a visit to the photographic exhibition Kevin Cummings' Joy Division and Beyond. It is one of the numerous exhibitions that demonstrate the openness of our museum to the multiple languages of contemporary art. Here you can see the photo of a recent exhibition organized as part of the Contemporary Tour project, in line with the spirit of an institution that made of the words of the archaeologist Riccardo Frankovic, archaeology is not only used to understand the past, but to build the present and the future, the pivot of its own cultural vision. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Lorenzo. Grazie mille. It was very clear, and also it stayed quite perfectly in our 10 minutes. So okay. I'll pass the word, coming back to the Netherlands, to the third Dutch guest, which is the Royal Netherlands Institute, which has a collaboration project with Italy too, that can present to us. So I pass the word to Asker Pelgrom.
Thank you very much, Federico. Let me share my screen with you. Okay, here we are. Are you seeing my screen now? Can anyone confirm, please?
Yes, we do. Yes, we
great.
Do.
Okay, great. My name is Oscar Pelgrom. I was the head of studies in history at the Royal Netherlands Institute in Rome until about a year ago. And in my Roman period, I initiated this project that I'm going to tell you a little bit about. And the project is about the digitization of the archive of the Dutch legation, so to speak, the Dutch embassy in Turin and Rome, a paper archive that spans the period from 1816 to 1874. So now for something completely different, I would say, almost, with respect to the museums we have been hearing about before. The project was initiated by the two institutions, of which you can see the logos here, the Royal Netherlands Institute in Rome, also known as KNIR, and the Istituto per la Storia del Risorgimento Italiano, also based in Rome. Maybe to start with just a few words about these two institutions. The Risorgimento Institute, found in 1936 and ever since housed in the Vittoriano in Rome, resorts directly under the Italian Ministry of Culture and has as its main task to document, investigate, and present materials regarding the history of Italian unification. And the KNIR, founded in 1904, can be defined as a mini campus of the United Dutch Universities in Rome. It offers short courses for students from these Dutch universities, mostly on history, art history, and archaeology. And it carries out its own research and facilitates research by partners from Dutch universities. Originally, at the beginning of the 20th century, however, the Dutch Institute was established as a research mission, a research outpost by the Dutch government, and its main task was to map and publish archival materials present in Italy pertaining to Dutch history and culture. Now, our project aims to reconnect, so to speak, this old mission of the Institute to the possibilities offered by 21st century technology. However, we do not do this alone and are proud and grateful to have a number of partners on board. First of all, the top left, the Embassy of the Kingdom of the Netherlands in Rome. It most generously supports our initiative with funding and can also play an important part, I think, in its presentation and outreach once the project results will be reached. Then on the top right, DANS, the Data Archiving and Network Services of the Royal Netherlands Academy of Science. It has also funded our project and will also serve for backup deposition of data and metadata. Then in the center, the University of Groningen, of which the KNIR is a part, it will host the data and metadata as well as the web portal that we will create. Then the National Archives in the Netherlands, that will help us to comply with digital archival standards, and the Segreteria di Stato Vaticano that has lent its formal adesione to the project and will be involved also in the presentation of the final results. Now, what is this archive about? Basically speaking, it is the archive of the Netherlands diplomatic mission in Turin and for 90% of the materials in Rome for most of the 19th century. As you know, the Italian national state came into being only in 1861, Rome becoming its capital in 1871. So in our case, we're talking about the Dutch embassy to the Holy See, basically. After much debate, the Dutch government decided to close this embassy in 1874. And instead of being transported back to the Netherlands, this archive was then temporarily deposited at the new Dutch embassy for the Kingdom of Italy. Unfortunately, shortly afterwards, it was stolen there and it disappeared for a few decades. And when it surfaced again at the end of World War I, the Dutch government tried to recover it in vain, but the Italian government did not want to yield it. And eventually the documents were then deposited in the Risorgimento Institute in the Vittoriano, where they are still kept today, in a place not easily accessible, and especially not for whom comes from abroad. And it's also hardly known to many scholars, we think. Now, its materials can be a real Fundgrube, so to speak, for diplomatic history in the 19th century, the history of Italo-Dutch political, cultural, and religious relations, the troubled history of Dutch Catholicism, and the history of the Risorgimento, and many more. It consists, as you can see, of many handwritten documents, mostly correspondence and reports by Dutch ambassadors and ministers, but also in some cases by some very prominent 19th century Italian figures such as Cavour or Cardinal Antonelli, and also of a number of printed pamphlets, journals, and magazine pages, sometimes with annotations. All of this in several languages, Italian, Dutch, and in most cases also French, as you can imagine. And the conditions of this material vary quite a lot, but as you can see, in some cases, digitization is rather urgent, because a few decades from now, we wouldn't be able to read some of these letters anymore. Now, what is the project about? It aims at the integral digitization of all documents and their presentation and disclosure on a new archival web portal. To this aim, we have had photographs made of all documents, as scans were not possible because these documents are bound together in large volumes and they cannot be fully opened. So they had to be photographed by hand, which was quite an adventure, but we managed to have this done. And we need also to draw a completely new inventory of all the materials, describing them one by one, page by page. Now, this last task of describing the materials is taken up by the head archivist of the Risorgimento Institute. He then sends these documents to us for control in order to harmonize them and make sure we meet all archival standards, and also to enable us to translate them in three different language versions. And these descriptions, as you can imagine, will then be the basis of our metadata and will be offered to the users in three languages, Italian, English, and Dutch. You might hear something more about this in a while from one of the project interns. Now, as a final result, we aim for an open source web portal in three languages where users can consult, view, and download these materials without any restrictions, and where they will also find many extra features, a well-thought search engine, links to other external data sets, information about the history of the archives, and biographies of the most important individuals mentioned in these documents. Once we will be ready, we intend to organize the official launch of the website in Rome and or maybe blended in The Hague. And after that, it will be our challenge to disseminate this fascinating collection among as many users interested as possible. We can do so, of course, through the platforms of our two institutions, their networks, newsletters, social media, etc., as well as by involving key players in the field of historical disciplines in our two countries, such as Huygens ING in the Netherlands or the Società Italiana per lo Studio della Storia Contemporanea in Italy, and by promoting the project on a number of platforms and magazines specialized in e-data, such as Digitalia in Italy or e-data and research in the Netherlands. Now, this project would not even have existed without two interns. And I have asked them to contribute as well to this short presentation. I don't know how much time we have. I think there's time to show a short video clip by Daniel and then leave the floor to Sigrid. Do we have 4 more minutes or something like that?
We have a couple of minutes, maybe 3.
Okay, well then let's skip the video. I can leave the PowerPoint to all of you to see the short video clip. And I want to leave the floor to Sigrid then. So I'm stopping sharing my screen. Here are 2 interns at work at the Vittoriano, Daniel and Sigrid. I'm going to stop sharing my screen now and leave the floor to Sigrid.
Yeah, if you would just go to the next slide, the last 2 slides.
Sorry, Ben. Here I'm back sharing my screen.
Yeah, and then the next one, I think it will be.
Yeah.
Yeah, and
no.
The one after that, yeah. That's Daniel, the other.
This is the one.
Yeah, okay. Great, perfect, yes. Okay, hi everyone. I'm Sigrid, so I work as an intern on this project since the summer. And I'll just shortly explain what I do. And what Daniel's also been doing. So mainly what we do is we make automated translations using a coding program that Daniel sort of set up so that the portal will be available in multiple languages. And on, aside from that, we also do research into the individuals that we come across in the archive. And we put all of that into a database of people that will be accessible with one click of the mouse later, so that you can see their place of death and their functions and titles that they held, etc. We also write short biographies for some of them, though this is really dependent on the sources that we have and also the frequency with which they turn up in the archive. So the research process itself really varies depending on the individual and also how well documented they are, because this differs. A good example is here on the page. You see on the left the picture of Cardinal Antonelli, who was, of course, the Secretary of State of the Vatican, of the Holy See, and who is fairly well known. And on the right, we have a letter from the archive from one Elder Jan Stelling, who was a Dutch ship owner. And we would not have found him probably if it hadn't been for the contents of the letter. He mentions his ship, which incurred damages near Civitavecchia. That's how we found him, through a maritime database. So the process really does, it really does depend on who it is, which makes the research very interesting. I've listed a few of the main portals that we do use in the middle on the page here, but generally what we hope for is to use biographical encyclopedias and national online archives, such as the Archivio del Senato and Parlamentum. In the cases of people that are less known, we try to use a contemporary almanac, such as the Annuario Pontificio. But there are always people that are very hard to find. So sometimes we have to draw the line and stop researching in those cases. But ultimately, what we want is to facilitate and to provide a platform for the user in the end. And we do this not only by providing our own database, but also by linking it to others, such as, could you go to the next slide, please? Also by linking it to others, such as Wikidata, which is sort of an overview of individuals, and every individual has a number, and also ISNI, and we link our locations to a geographical database, that's geolocations. So we also try to expand the reach. And on top of that, we would also like to reap the benefits of the research that we hope to produce, or not the research that is produced by our users, which means collecting new data from them and letting them contribute through annotation and enabling users to add transcriptions, for instance. And in this way, sort of keeping the archive dynamic and ever alive in its online space. So to conclude on that note, we're doing very exciting things, and personally, I'm very eager to see it all come to life and to see it in its online form. So thank you so much for your attention. And if you have questions, of course, we will be in the chat.
Thank you, Sigrid. It was very, very clear. I will give the floor to the sixth and last but not least, the last presentation for on the Italian side. So we have the Parco Archeologico di Ostia Antica, represented by Dario Daffara and Maria Chiara Guerra. We see your presentation, I reassure you. And I think Dario is presenting first, or am I correct? Yeah. Who is going first?
Yeah, it's me. Sorry, because I had some problem with my presentation and my webcam, but seems to work now. Do you hear me?
Yeah, I hear you, I see you, and I see the slides.
Perfect. So, good afternoon, and thank you all for this invitation and for this talk between our institutes. Let me introduce very briefly my institution. I am an archaeologist in the Archaeological Park of Ostia Antica, which is an independent institute within the Italian Ministry of Culture. It is one of the largest archaeological parks in Italy, including various archaeological sites, natural attraction, and historical monuments. And today I will focus my speech on educational activities, but we also have many projects about digitalization and valorization of our bibliographic and artistic heritage. But maybe I will talk about that another time, because we don't have many time today. So one of the missions of our institute is the spread and implementation of educational activities, which we address to various age groups. So please, Maria Chiara, the next one. So this is an aerial view of Ostia Antica. As I said, it's one of the biggest archaeological area in Italy. And next one, please. For example, we have workshops for school children, like this one. Next one. Or also this one is make your own watercolors. And next one, I will go faster. And also this one, and so on, so on, so on. This is the previous one, please. This is our school to work exchange program with high school in our territory. Next one. And I came to the main program of this talk. With the pandemic, we have to rethink most of our activities, and the need was to stay in touch with our audience while being far from them. Thanks to the resource of our budget, we were able to create a series of educational videos like this one, with exercises and activities, which we uploaded on our websites, achieving good results in terms of views and involvement. We also created a didactic magazine. The next one, please. This is our magazine, the Quaderni of Cartiglio, which is our mascot, this cat on the right of the screen. And in this magazine, we included several stories with trivia and games, and you can find it on our website with all the other material seen before. And within these activities, the proposal of Rapsodie Digitali seemed to us not only interesting to draw children's attention on the cultural heritage of Ostia, but also for the innovative cooperation with the scientific world, because ancient Oster could be an extraordinary lab to explain science. We are already planning to expand this project, and I thank you for the attention. It was a very short presentation, but I think you should listen to Maria Chiara, who is the project manager of this project. And so I give floor to her. Thank you very much.
So thank you, Dario, and thank you all for the opportunities to introduce Rapsodie Digitali, a digital storytelling of Ostia Antica. As Dario said, I'm the project manager and the designer, but I'm also the spokesperson of a very multidisciplinary team. So, actually, Rapsodie Digitali has been promoted by Affabulazione, a cultural association based in Ostia, in partnership with Parco Archeologico di Ostia Antica, INFN, Istituto Nazionale di Fisica Nucleare, Teatro del Lido di Ostia, and it was sponsored by Poste Italiane, the largest logistic operator in Italy. It also got the patronage of the 10 municipality of Rome. But why did we set up a project like this right in Ostia? Because Ostia owns an extraordinary cultural heritage, but it's also a really fragile territory in terms of marginalization. So we want to promote the knowledge of Ostia Antica, making it a permanent educational place. We want to define a new image of Ostia throughout a positive storytelling, and we want children, the future generation of citizens, to design it. Another important goal consists in providing the incoming visitors with a digital guide of site. In addition, we want to provide children and teachers with a peer-to-peer educational resource, not only for studying Roman history, but also for studying art, technology, and science. As I say, the design team is really, really multidisciplinary. It includes one acting coach, one archaeologist, one nuclear physicist beside me. I'm an architect and a PhD in cultural heritage. But the main character in this game have been 25 children coming from the local primary schools. We define a 3-step program merging experiences in attendance and digital outcomes. The first step consists in a 2-week summer camp. Week one took place in the archaeological site of Ostia Antica, where the students discovered the park led by the archaeologists, but also explored the scientific and technological topics over the material heritage. In week two, the camp moved to Teatro del Lido di Ostia, and there students learned how to be a storyteller, chose their favorite archaeological or scientific topic, and wrote the contents. During the final days, they shot videos throughout the green screen technology. In the early fall, the videos were reviewed by experts and then published on the website rapsodiedigitali.it. Last November, the outcomes were also shared with the students and families during a sort of public premiere at Teatro del Lido. So I will scroll through some expressive picture of the camp. Day one, the topic was water. So the archaeologist, you can see Dario in the picture, he led the group around the site and made the children discover fountains and thermae. Then they were involved in scientific experiments about the fluid mechanics by the INFN physicist. Day two, the topic was the sound. The students took part to a tour from the theater to the Thermopolium, and then they explored the physical properties of sound as a mechanical wave. Day three, the topic was universe. So after visiting the Mitraeum of Felicissimo and the mosaic depiction of several deities, our physicists involved the children in a special lab about the universe. Day four, topic was the city. The tour was about the structure of the Roman city, the castrum, and then the student discovered the secrets of the Earth's magnetism. Day five, the last one, in the park. Dario led the group to visit the Casa di Diana and its frescoes, and then the physicists made the children experience the property of lights and colors. So, as I said, during the week two, the camp moved to Teatro del Lido. So the students gained confidence with storytelling supported by an acting coach. She made them practice starting with Shakespeare's masterpieces. Then each student chose one favorite archaeological topic and or one favorite scientific experiment, wrote the script for the video, and finally went on stage. So yeah, we are some picture of the shooting. And finally, let's take a look to the head camps. All the educational resources are now available, as I said, on rapsodiedigitali.it. And here you can see on the top left, the 15 minutes full documentary, followed by 7 short videos, listen like archaeological findings. Each video express and explores a different topic chosen by the children themselves. The history of the excavation, the water structure, the secret of Roman theater, and so on. So in November, we released the website and we were very glad of the widespread of the videos. Actually, they have been shared on the website of the main Italian newspapers like Corriere della Sera and Repubblica. So I shall conclude quoting some participants' impressions. Children appreciated really much the location and felt very, very welcome. After two pandemic years, they need to experience a new way of learning, surrounded by beauty and culture in a very special natural place. And therefore, families gave us wonderful feedbacks about this experience. So we really hope to repeat this experience next summer. And I really want to thank you for your attention. And I want you to enjoy one of these video.
Ve le ricordate le parti?
Assolutamente sì.
Ma io ti ho dovuto sentire.
Lo sapete chi è stata la prima persona a scavare nel parco archeologico di Ostia Antica?
No!
È stato Dante Vallieri.
Dante Alighieri.
Ma non aveva scritto la Divina Commedia? Dante Vallieri e Dante Alighieri sono due personaggi diversi. Sì, infatti Dante Vallieri ha iniziato con gli scavi del parco nel 1900. Non c'erano i macchinari che ci stanno adesso, le ruspe, le trivelle. Usavano semplicemente le mani, quindi usavano zappe, vanghe e picconi. E con i muli portavano via la terra.
E che cosa gli serviva tutta quella terra?
Con la terra l'hanno usata per arginare il fiume Tevere, il fiume che passa accanto ad Ostia. Se così, in caso di inondazioni, non veniva inondata. Dante Vallieri ha fatto tantissime cose, infatti.
Guarda che non c'era solo lui. Avete mai sentito parlare di Raissa Calza?
E mo chi è sta Raissa Calza?
Raissa Calza è stata una donna molto importante per la storia di Ostia. Lei è andata a recuperare la testa della statua della Dea Roma che era stata rubata durante la guerra dai nazisti ed era anche la moglie di Guido Calza, uno degli aiutanti del tuo famigerato Dante Alighieri.
Dante Vallieri.
Thank you.
Grazie. Grazie Maria Chiara. So we came to an end with the sixth presentation. I want to say thank you to all the guests and the speakers. We are having 10 minutes pause, but we will come back in 10 minutes with to start the dialogue among the Italian speakers and also some of the Dutch guests that can speak Italian, because I know that Esker and Hannah can speak some Italian, so they can stay with us also for the second round. We listened to 6 very different presentations. We have a couple of projects which are really changing the shape of an entire organization. and so also changing the relation with the audience, Musei Reali, Marta, for example. And we have a specific communication and digital communication projects, like the one that storytelling projects that, like the one that the Parco Archeologico di Ossa presented right now. And so we have very different stages and challenges of the digital engagement. In the second part, we want to start exactly from this point. So we want to start asking you how these projects are changing the relation with your audiences, how you can engage and relate with different kind of audiences, and also which kind of results do you have from your projects. The second part of the conversation will be held in Italian. I ask also to our speakers to take a look to the questions and answers section, because you have maybe some questions for you. For example, some of our guests are interested by the presentation of Lorenzo Mancini of Marta. They are asking for some specific questions. And so if you don't have any other, if you don't have anything to add, I can give you the 10 minutes break, and we can start again at 4:15.